The Lexi Show starts now.
They understood it. They couldn't read it. Because so I wasn't happy well, about life.
I pray.
I can't tell by the sound of your voice if you're really in love with me.
That love God and will love me the way God loves me.
And you are.
They're a free spirit.
I'm blessed. I am blessed.
No, I hurt
can't lie.
A lot of people.
If I say to you, baby, I love you, then baby, I love you. Oh, and I do. Yes, I do.
I am so glad that you took the time to be with me today. And I can call you, I often called you pastor in the past.
Yes, yes.
But now you're bishop.
Yes, ma'am.
You are Bishop O.C. Allen. You started your church in your living room?
In my living room,
okay.
Yes.
Okay. How many people could you fit in your living room?
Well, we brought 12 people. And I would say you could fit 14 in there.
Okay.
Yeah, we started with 12 members. Really, it's 14 members, because me and my partner, and then 12 people. And literally, it was made up of primarily people that were very over church.
Okay.
Just over church, just church folks.
Yeah.
Real churchy people,
right.
But over church.
Just over it.
Just over church, over hypocrisy, over just church hurt. I don't like to use that word because the church didn't hurt people. It's people that hurt people. But that's the word that
we use.
That's
right?
The buzzword, church hurt, like the whole church hurt. Needless to say, we brought these people together and we laid it out on the table. God has called us to create a space that is Christ-centered, that is solely focused on Jesus. But what we will do is make sure that Jesus is accessible to everybody in a very profound and loving way.
They call you the first gentleman.
They do.
They call you First G.
First G.
I love First G.
First G.
I heard old G.
Uh-huh.
But First G. Rashad, when did you come to this church? Did you start?
Yeah, the church started in our living room.
Yeah?
In our living room, 2005, March of 2005. That's when we started.
How long have you been partners with Bishop Allen?
Since 2003. Since the end of 2002, going into 2003.
You kind of work as a PR. Is that your official title? You do PR for the church?
I do his big stuff.
Okay.
I do his big stuff.
You were a little apprehensive of me coming here. Why?
Love you. But want to make sure that the integrity of the ministry and the integrity of his work is kept intact. And we have spent much time, blood, tears, resources building this. And even people who mean well can be even destructive in their effort to be helpful. So we wanted to make sure that what has been built would not be attacked and through a process of trying to spread the word.
And I want to handle this with kid gloves. I really do, because I believe that every voice is important.
Absolutely.
I believe that every belief is important.
Absolutely.
Every opinion is important. It's not people that agree with me, that agree with you.
Absolutely.
You know, and I don't like people who we call ourselves Christians and we can't even listen.
Right.
We can't even sit down.
Right.
We can't talk.
Right. And, you know, I think the biggest reason, honestly, is I love him. And I take very seriously my call as first gentleman as to protect and cover him.
Yeah.
And I'll give my life doing it.
How long have you been at Bishop's Church?
Since day one.
So you're one of the founding members?
Yes, I'm one of the ones who sat in the living room when we talked about the Vision Church, the inception of it, yes.
Wow. So how long have you known Bishop?
I have known him, I guess I want to say 7.5 years now.
Okay.
I was going to another church that he was going to, and to make a long story short, I was getting ready to leave that church because some things were going on. I need the word to be the word, and the word was no longer the word. I was taught that the word ought to be line upon line and precept upon precept. So that's what I needed, and I wasn't getting anymore, and I talked to the Lord about it. And he was, I never sit in the back of the church. You know, I was raised holiness, so, you know, you're in the back, you're sinning. So, yeah, uh-huh. So I, you know, sat in the balcony, and I heard the Lord speak to me and say, go tell that man you're ready when he is. And at the end of service, I went and tapped him, and I said, hi, how are you? He said, I'm fine. I said, I want to let you know that the Lord told me to tell you that I'm ready when you are. And you know, when people say the Lord said, we go to frowning, because, yeah. So he looked at me, you know, in a way and said, have a nice day. And for the next three Sundays, the Lord told me to do the same thing. And on that fourth time, he started crying and gave me his phone number. And unbeknownst to me, he was starting a ministry.
So we have a mother and daughter team that's here. So I heard that you're not the only mother here. I heard that there's a mother's board.
There's a mother's board, yes.
Okay. Right.
Yes.
Wow. What has Visions Church done for you in your life?
It has really enabled me to hone in on my vision and walk in it.
That's good.
Yeah.
And you've seen that happen in the lives of others?
Yes.
Other people walk out their vision?
Yes.
Yeah.
And I know everybody had talked about the 25 people that joined last Sunday. I can't even begin to tell you how my heart was so overwhelmed just to see the young people just come to God. And Bishop really delivers that message that it's for all people. And I look at John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And he delivers that. When I see him carry that message, it's like he's fully anointed. And it's not him speaking, it's God speaking through him to the people. And the people really takes that in, and I see it manifested here. And I was baptized at 6 years old, and I'm not ashamed to tell it. The Lord blessed me to see 60.
Well, come on. I want to make this clear. You don't want this show to be about the gay thing.
No.
This is a gay church, and
No. It's
not about that for you. For you.
Well, first of all, I don't even think that notion makes sense.
Yeah.
Because if a church is going to be identified by its majority population, then there's a lot of gay churches. If there are churches that are going to be identified by the orientation or the gender that's predominant in the space, you know what that means. Then we got to call it a woman's church. Then most of the churches we grew up in are female churches.
Mm. Yeah.
Because the majority of the congregation was female. That's really what I believe. The second part about that is that that's not my lane. The direction or the foundation of this church is not to be surrounded by my orientation or the orientation of the people in the room.
Yeah.
My lane. Now, having said that, that may be other people's lanes. That's not what we're talking about. I think, you know, we talk about the AME church. It was created because of a need to have a space for African Americans during a certain period in history.
Sure.
I get it. And that's what people were called to do. My lane is to create a space where the focal point can be Jesus Christ. The focal point can be what the blood has done, the blood of Jesus Christ, has done for everybody, and not make it about these distinctions that don't save us, these distinctions that don't redeem us, and these distinctions that don't make us successful and healthy and profound people in the world.
Yeah.
And so we've been like that from day one. People try to put us in boxes and, you know, but again, that's not, that doesn't bother me. I don't answer to that. That's not, I am very clear about my assignment.
I ran from ministry, I ran from my calling, because I'm going to hell, so God can't use me.
When did that change for you? When did you...
When I was leaving my last church, I was running from ministry, and God spoke to me clearly and said, you're disobedient. And I made excuses. God, this is why I can't do it. You know why. And he said, but you're disobedient. I'm telling you to do what I called you to do. You won't do it. That's not a factor. Hmm. It was mind-shattering, but I'm like, okay. But I can't say at a place where they're telling me I'm going to hell, that God can't use me like this. So it was time to go.
When did you come out to your family, friends?
Last year, actually. To my mother, Thanksgiving last year.
How did she react?
I told my brothers 2 months before. So they were cool, like, whatever, who cares? My mother came for Thanksgiving. At this point, I'm almost 38 at the time. And she came around, and everybody was there. And so the day after Thanksgiving, she just laughingly asked me. She saw a picture in my house and was like, what's this? And I was like, a picture? And she was like, no, you know what I'm talking about. Are you participating in something alternative? And I said, no, I'm not participating in anything alternative. I'm doing what's natural to me.
Wow. That's how you told her?
Mm-hmm.
Did you plan on telling her that day, or it just came out?
It just came out. I was going to wait for her to bring it out, because it was going to be natural.
Yeah.
She'd already been here, and she was like, oh, I wonder why some things and people you hang around, but, you know, it doesn't change anything.
She had been to Visions Church?
Yes. My mother's been here several times.
I believe that we were called to create a space and a place for everybody.
Yeah.
And I know there are a lot of churches and a lot of ministries, a lot of Christians, a lot of believers who believe that in theory.
Everybody says that. Everybody. We're global. Yeah. We're a global ministry. We're one church in 16 locations, and we're feeding, you know, the hungry and clothing the homeless and the needy, and, you know, we want to be everything to everybody.
Mm-hmm. But it's a different thing to really put that in action, to create a space for all people. You know, Christians, we talk about God loves everybody.
Yeah.
And that the gospel is for everybody, that redemption is for the world. But it's a very different thing to actually create a space mm-hmm. that is intentional about it. And I know that most oftentimes, mm-hmm. getting back to your first question, mm-hmm. Most oftentimes people see an inclusive ministry, and people use that word as meaning one thing.
It's the buzzword now.
Yeah, it's the buzzword.
Yeah.
Most oftentimes in this season or this generation, people typically mean the inclusion of gays and lesbians.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's not the complete definition of inclusion.
There's no way you could walk into this church and not feel different when you leave.
So it's not just about it, you know, being a gay church. It's not about that.
Well, it's an all-inclusive church, a church where anyone of any nationality, any sexuality can come here, praise and worship God, and learn about God and how he lives through us and everything that he's placed us on this earth for. I wouldn't consider it a gay church, but because that's more of the interest, you would say publicly, then that's how he gets that tag. But I see this place as a place where anybody can come here and worship and feel comfortable to praise God. I can stand up with a male or a female and not be judged, but be loved as God would love us.
What has Visions Church done for your walk with the Lord?
Vision Church has affirmed my calling in ministry and helped me to actually operate in authenticity. I am who I am. I can bring all of me into the room and worship God real. Don't have to play games, don't have to hide anything. Our church is about praising God, worshiping God, teaching people that Jesus loves you where you are, regardless of anything else.
To be a truly inclusive ministry is to be a ministry that really represents God's diversity, God's family. And that's everybody. That is everybody.
Whites,
blacks, seniors, youth, everybody. Every gender, every ethnicity, every background, in one space.
Yeah. What has Visions Church done for you?
I'm going to try not to be touched.
Oh, no, come on.
A lot.
Talk to me. Okay, let me start.
I'm a crier.
Well, I grew up in a Presbyterian environment, and this is more of a praise and worship. I didn't even know what praise and worship was. We used to have camp meeting, and we would have all sorts of events, and preachers come out, but the higher calling, this is such a higher calling. The message is very heartfelt. It hits the people right where they want to be hit. It doesn't minister to the people. It talks to the hearts of the people. Many times you can go into a church, and I've been in church all my life. Got to know Jesus at 9 years old. But this church is phenomenal. Phenomenal.
How has it changed you and your views of the Lord? Or is it the same? Or?
I always knew I had a higher calling on my life. Yeah. And some of the churches that I've gone to is like punching a clock. You get a little bit of a message, and you go in and you come out, and you just say you went to church. Here, it's a life-changing event.
Every time that people walk up Ormwood Avenue, we want them, as they're walking closer, to feel a little more of God's love. And we hope that when people walk in these doors, they're embraced and they're loved. That's why we do the welcoming of the visitors.
Yeah.
And we have them stand up, mm-hmm. and we have members go around and greet them and greet each other.
Yeah.
Because for some people, that is the only hug they get all week.
Wow.
And we do not take that lightly. And at least I don't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're no dummy. You have matriculated through some of the finest institutions. You're a really smart, brilliant man. And every time I hear your name, people always talk about how smart you are.
Okay.
Okay. It went to Morehouse. Go ahead and name some of your universities. You're studying currently at Harvard?
At Harvard University.
When are you going to finish up there?
Well, you keep praying.
Hey.
Yeah, I'm studying organizational development and leadership. And I have had the awesome opportunity to study in some great places, Morehouse College, Morgan State University.
They say you can always tell a Morehouse man.
Yes, I believe that.
You just can't tell him much.
Not much. Yeah,
that's what I've heard.
Yeah.
It's a great school.
Yeah, great institutions. And the truth is, that is what has given me the intellectual tools that are needed to pastor and lead. And I say that because I think, you know, everybody has a call.
Absolutely.
Everybody has a call. But it can't just be you've been trained spiritually. Mm-hmm. You have to have a theological foundation. Mm-hmm. And it comes from study. It comes from intellectual rigor, which will, you know, it doesn't give you the anointing,
nope.
but it certainly makes your anointing more effective. And that is where I was able to really get a grasp on what it would mean to pastor and lead this generation, and particularly a place that is for everybody. Being able to sit and learn about various cultures,
mm-hmm.
to take classes, you know, women's studies, mm-hmm. Classes that were specific to understanding the history, the psychology of women,
yeah.
has helped me be a better pastor. All those things, I think, are crucial to leadership.
Absolutely.
Yeah, ministry.
You know, our bishop, you know, God has used him so tremendously to get through to me. And it's, you know, I have a tendency of having a little hard head.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, my bishop is so
patient. Yeah,
and, you know, he just, God just gets through him to get through me. And it's just a wonderful thing, you know. I love him so much. He's brought me through the thick and the thin, you know, and he's so passionate with it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and I know that he has a lot going on. I don't get a chance to speak to him much. So what I do is, you know, I ask one of the elder Raquel, I said, would it be nice if I get Bishop a nice gift, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, how would I give it to him? She said, could you give it to him? She said, no, you give it to him. I said, well, gift to him. She said, when you go up there to offering, you go to the pulpit and you say, hey, Bishop, come here. And I did just what she told me. He just hugged me and gave me a hug. And I just felt that connection, that spirit. I could have stayed up there the whole service.
Wow.
You know, he's awesome.
And accessible.
And much so.
And so I know what you're saying, because there's a lot of church. There are a lot of churches that have so many people.
Yes.
They don't get to know their pastor. They don't get to. The pastor doesn't know their name. And when you can be, when you have a bishop that can be accessible, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, that too. But if it had not been, I still feel a connection. If he never even said anything to me, or never knew who I was, or if I was watching him on via satellite, I would send him a gift.
I love my bishop. When I came to this church, I was not going anyplace else. I actually came to the church to appease a friend. Okay, I'll come to your church. Say, leave me alone. I won't go to nobody else's church.
Were you done with church?
I was done.
You weren't going to church at all.
I stopped. The January of the year I joined this church, I was sitting in my last church, and I heard a voice say, this is your last Sunday. And I'm like, I'm losing my mind. And I got up and took my Bible, and I left. I never went back. Hmm. Came over here, and when I was leaving this church, God said, I'm sending you over there to pray and to do what I called you to do. And I'm like, yeah. 5 years later, I'm walking in my calling. My bishop is a man of God. He was anointed. I don't follow foolishness. Because I know the way. And I support him 100% in what we're doing here. We're transforming people's lives.
The bishop doesn't bring people in just to bring people in, and he's very clear on that.
And it's, to say that we're building numbers and...
Absolutely, absolutely. And it shows with the people that are... I mean, we have typically no less than 12 people join every Sunday. And I can attest, I have gone down, which breaks my heart because it's the church that I grew up in. Mm-hmm. And I can remember coming down, and I was the only one. And not one minister came up to me. Here, you are so embraced.
I saw that.
We have elders, deacons, pastors that will embrace you, that will take you to the next level.
We started with 12 people, and we have over 3,000 on the roll.
Yeah.
Bible study is like service. Those who can't get here on Sunday, they can get everything they need in Bible study.
God has multiplied this ministry.
Oh my God, by leaps and bounds. On a Sunday, we can have about 20 to 25 people join on a Sunday, any given Sunday.
It's major.
Yeah, it is.
Changing
indeed.
Lives, that's amazing.
Yes, yes, that's who God is. He changes lives. He wouldn't be God if he didn't. I never thought after transitioning that I would be able to function in ministry again. So to be able to function in ministry and help Bishop move God's people from vision to victory, a wonderful thing.
Have you seen that happen here?
Yeah, right before my eyes.
You love your bishop?
I love him. That's my dad.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. You learning a lot in the
world? A lot.
So it's not just coming to church for church's sake?
No. I'm not one of a type of person that just do something for the sake of doing it. It has to be a purpose behind it. And the lessons, the information that I get here are tools that help me through my life. It helps me walk through my vision, helps me stay clear as into what I'm here on this earth for.
How proud are you of this ministry and what you've helped?
I'm extremely.
Yeah.
I'm extremely proud. Yeah. It gives me joy. I think the greatest moment in our services mm-hmm. is when we open the doors of the church and people walk down those aisles, because I know that they are beginning a new chapter in their journey. And I can see their life changing as they are walking down those aisles.
Yeah.
And for some people, they have spent their entire life struggling to love themselves, to accept themselves, dealing with so much rejection. And so when I see them enter into a moment mm-hmm. where they have the ability to begin to experience healing mm-hmm. and reconciliation, mm-hmm. it really gives my heart much joy.
How difficult is it to be married to Bishop O.C. Allen?
He actually makes it much easier than it could be. It actually is a lot of love and a lot of fun. We actually enjoy each other, and we are friends, and so that's helpful.
Yeah.
So, but it's also a lot of sacrifice, and it's a lot of work.
Just like with anything.
Just like with anything.
It's a ministry. People call the house.
They do.
When they should call one of the elders.
They should.
And they.
Can you tell them?
They should.
They should.
Please call. One
please
of
call.
If you're watching now, please.
Please call elder, minister, deacon. No.
You tired of fighting?
I.
I'm not tired of fighting. I'm tired of fighting the wrong fight. And that's not my lane. My lane is not to answer my critics. I tell this church all the time, you don't defend your church. Let this ministry and the testimonies of this ministry defend itself. So I don't answer my critics. I don't spend time debating. You know, the Bible talks about not debating scripture. You don't use God and the Bible to debate. That's not what it's for. It's to give life. And so I don't mind fighting the enemy. I don't mind fighting principalities. That's my lane. But it is not my lane to attempt to try to change how people feel about certain things. That's not my job. I think if you walk in the doors of this church, there are some things that you cannot deny, whether you understand everything or not. You cannot deny the presence of God. You cannot deny what it means to be in a room when people feel loved. You cannot deny how people have been changed and transformed. You can't deny the testimonies about how people got into recovery. You can't deny how people's families came back and how people learned how to reconcile.
Our church is about praising God, worshiping God, teaching people that Jesus loves you where you are, regardless of anything else.
Now, people can say, because you grew up, as I did, and so you know what they're saying, you know what the naysayers are saying. When did you become comfortable with it and say, you know what, I know what you're saying, people who are watching right now, what do you have to say to the naysayers that say, oh my God, he is in error, and he's just telling himself that to make himself feel better, but they're all going to hell?
What I've learned from what everybody else taught me was, God does not abide in foolishness, and God does not abide where he is not, what he does not approve of. I tell everybody who has something to say about our church, come to our church and you experience the anointing in our church, you know God is here. If God's anointing is here, he said his approval on the house. So there must be something else going on.
When I was 18, I was a student at University of Chicago, where actually President Obama taught law school. And I was there and I was doing some research on HIV and AIDS in a black church. Mm-hmm. And somehow God connected me with a little white lady out the seminary. And she was my advisor in my research. And I began to wrestle scripturally, and I began to wrestle just with myself. And I entered into a space of reconciliation. And I became clear that God loved me. God would not create something such as myself and not love that which he created.
Next week on The Lexi Show.
That not only is this moment happening for me, but this moment can happen for you. That's what this church is about.
I asked my mom, and I said, Mom, is something wrong with me? I said, because I'm different. She said, yes. She said, you're gay.
Like us on Facebook by searching for The Lexi Show.